Well, hello, everyone. And I have these wonderful ladies. And we have spent some time today out having coffee and at the tables. And so we're looking forward to a very good dialogue back and forth. But I guess one of the things that as we sat there and we were listening to all the great panels that came before, wanted to start with, there's not an option to change and to become more diverse and more inclusive. By 2030, the majority of young workers in America will be people of color. And by 2044, the majority of America will be people of color. So it's nice to think that, oh, we're going to wait and figure out who's in college or how to recruit people, but that's actually not going to be the makeup. That is not going to be the people there to recruit. And so when you look at what does that mean and how do we create diversity and inclusion within manufacturing as well as other industries, what does that look like to you?
So we have about 500,000 jobs open in manufacturing today. So I think Barbara said this on the first panel this morning. We don't have a choice. We need people. We need all people. And we have a pretty significant perception challenge in the sector to begin with. It is old, it is majority white, it is majority male, it is dirty, dark, and dangerous. And in fact, manufacturing today is none of those things. But our industrial heritage, you know, I always go back to the arsenal of democracy and all these amazing things that manufacturing has made happen in the sector, which is fantastic. But the reality is modern manufacturing looks and feels different than when I was a kid going to the factory with my dad and my grandfather. That's why we do things like Creators Wanted, the giant blue wall behind you, telling the story of what manufacturing employees look like today, because those are the stories that are going to help you connect, help people of color and from diverse backgrounds see that there is a future for them. So for us, it's people. We need people. We need all people with diverse backgrounds and experience. That's going to make us better as companies. That's going to make us stronger as an economy. And that's going to help us compete in the world.
And when you look at the notion of, we've talked a lot today about diversity. Right. And certainly on the board behind us, it talks about inclusion. Those are very different things. So kind of how do you look at those things differently to really be able to articulate what does that mean?
Sure. So I encourage you all to take a look at the report we just released with PwC last week on this topic. And it really encapsulates and really focuses on the good work that's being done in the sector and what's happening in manufacturing in diversity and inclusion. I think this is a great throw to Alka to talk about her experience. But it's not just we need a diverse workforce. We need to look out and say, okay, we are diverse. We're meeting our metrics. We're measuring the right things, and we're getting there. It's how do those employees feel about where they are? That's the inclusion part. So diversity is an important part of the equation. We need to focus on that because we need to bring a diverse population into our factories, into our facilities, and our businesses. But we need to make sure they are included and that they feel welcome, that their voices are heard, that they have a place to go, a community that they are a part of, so that they stay. Because for manufacturers, it's not just attracting the workforce, it's keeping them and retaining them that is really critical.
And Alka, so her story is phenomenal. I mean, besides being a lawyer and working at a bank and now at CMU, she started in manufacturing. So you were a woman and a person of color in manufacturing, and then you tried to go back to manufacturing. What was that? What did that feel like to you?
Sure. So after I graduated from Pitt in engineering school, my first job was at a steel mill, the La Trobe Steel, and it was the only job I could find locally. I wanted to stay here. And so I was the first young hire after 15 years, right? So imagine sort of the age gap. I was one of four women engineers, and I was the only woman engineer of color. And so, as you can imagine, I kind of had sort of three barriers or obstacles to kind of overcome. And so, I can tell you, while from a professional work experience, it was a great learning opportunity, from a personal experience, it was a challenge, right? Like, the feeling of belonging, the feeling of inclusion, the feeling of, like, who do I go to talk to about certain issues? I didn't have anyone, right? And I think it was really critical, too, to your point, Carolyn, about having visible role models, right? So there were four other women engineers there, but did I see them in senior leadership levels? Did I see a career path? What was I going to do, you know, as I progressed in my experiences? And so I think Steve probably guessed this, and I think he said this at the beginning. I ended up leaving the manufacturing world and got my law degree because I didn't feel like I belonged, and I didn't know where my place was in that field. Fast forward 10 years practicing law, went back to a steel company and now as a lawyer, and I thought, okay, it's been 10 years, things have changed, right? And it hadn't. I was the only female person of color lawyer in the legal department, and those discussions of how to be included, how to feel belonging, wasn't there. And again, I wasn't seeing the female women of color leadership role models, right? Like, so, you know, if you want to... you want to progress to something, you want to have someone kind of guide you, you want mentors and sponsors, and every time I looked around, there was no one that looked like me, that I felt comfortable talking to, and that was definitely a challenge.
I think one of the things that we're seeing is you have to be deliberate, right? We've right. seen for a long time, for the past 20 years, right, there's been a business case for diversity, how that will help you be more profitable, how that will help you innovate more, and yet companies have made the decision that that's okay. I can do a $2 billion deal, but I still can't change my workforce to be diverse. So what's going to change to say now is the time? Who does that? Is it the CEO? Is it this new workforce coming in? Who's accountable?
So I feel like you got to start at the top, and that's why CEO action has such an important role. And we heard this from Dan earlier from Ingersoll Rand. You need to have leadership say, this is a business imperative for us. We need to affect change from the top. We need to, they would say in manufacturing, you know, we do what we can measure, right? That is where the focus goes. So we need to set that and we need to put that in. But we also need to work across the community. We need to talk about the opportunities. We need to change the perception so that people know this is an opportunity they can go seek. Manufacturers have gone from a time where you just hung out the open, you know, the help wanted sign and people came to you, that now we're in an economy where we need to go and find them and mm-hmm. recruit them. We need to actively engage. So we need to think about what is the diverse environment, what are the diverse audiences. Louise talked about this before. How do you go to different institutions and recruit? How do you talk to the institutions about their recruitment so they are pulling from diverse populations into their student body for us to then? So we've got to go both ways because this is a crisis. Mm-hmm. We cannot compete without the workers. People are, the robots are coming, but they are not taking over. I say that every day. We still need people at the heart of what we do at manufacturing. So therefore, the skills are changing, the jobs are changing. Employees will say they're doing more interesting things with critical thinking and the things that they enjoy because they don't have to do the basic things that they don't like as much or that could hurt them, that's repetitive. That's what the machines are doing. So we need people with different skill sets. And so we need to tell a better story. We need to change from the top and measure things differently and have a focus on it. But we need to work together to show what the opportunities are.
Mm-hmm. And I'll just add, you know, I really think it takes intentionality and accountability, right? I think those are the two critical factors. And it's kind of been touched on throughout this morning. But really, and I think this was highlighted in the report, the thought leadership piece that both organizations have put together, this isn't an HR imperative, right? This is a business strategy, right? And so as a potential employee of an organization, I'm going to see whether you're really serious about it. And I'm going to go look at your board of directors. I'm going to go look at your senior leadership and see, does anyone look like me, right? Does anyone have experiences like me? And that will really be, telling. In terms of accountability, metrics, right? Being able to measure metrics and being able to demonstrate that things are happening. And I think those are going to be critical pieces. I also think that this new generation isn't going to put up with this, right? Like, we can only talk about this for so long. We can only talk about the fact that we're interested in diversity and inclusion. We're trying, right? But I think this younger generation is going to force the issue and force the conversation to change and demand results.
Well, it's interesting. I think we've gone so long, to your point, of trying to measure, right? So diversity is the number that's in the box. And we're going to try to do things and programs and tools to move what's in the box. But what we're talking about now is creating a culture mm-hmm. that's inclusive. Creating a culture that people can actually belong in and they feel a part of. And I think one of the things with CEO Action for Diversity and Inclusion that now 508 CEOs have signed up for, one of the things that they've all agreed to do is to start having difficult conversations in the workplace. So think about all the things that you're not allowed to talk about at work. You're not allowed to talk about race, LGBTQ, religion, politics. Well, you know what? Because we all see that after we leave work, all over the weekends and all of our time, how can you get to work and not talk about those things? We have to talk about it. And yes, at the panel before, talking about race is really hard. But if we don't talk about it, how in the world can you create a culture that's welcoming to it?
How can we be deliberate about solving it if we can't even talk about it in the first place? So that inclusion part, that cohesiveness part, having that community, the employee resource groups, having that place to go, seeing what the career paths are and the opportunities are, and being able to have that mentorship and people that you can say, okay, I can aspire to that because I can see it. That's especially important for the kids and for youth today. Everywhere I go across the country to talk about manufacturing careers and opportunity, they'll say to me, if you can't see it, you can't be it. You need to see, you need to have the role model, you need to understand what those jobs, that career path, those opportunities are, and see that it is welcome and opening for you.
Right, and I think it's really important to have transparency around that process, right? So for individuals who are coming into organizations, what does that progression look like? And then I would challenge organizations to look at their current job descriptions, right? They might be 10 years old, and maybe you did need 5 years of experience in certain things back then, but not anymore, right? Think people are agile, skills are, you know, people are developing their skills. And so being really transparent about it, using technology to see whether your job descriptions are gender neutral, right? And there are ways to do this, right? But it takes intentionality, it takes time to think about this and go back, and it takes work and effort. For sure.
And it's worth the doing.
Definitely. Yeah.
Absolutely. And so I know we are out of time, but the one thing I would encourage you all to do if you haven't is outside is the CEO Action for Diversity and Inclusion Unconscious Bias Blind Spots Bus. And what I think is important is in addition to having CEOs say we need to have difficult conversations, whether it's around the Me Too movement, whether it's around a shooting that happens, whatever it is, we have to talk about that in the workplace and understand what our people are feeling. The other thing we have to do is realize we all bring biases to the table, whether we think we do or not, and we have to be acknowledge them, be thoughtful to them, and make sure we address them so it doesn't cause us to make decisions that are unintentional but are really intentionally hurting our workforce and hurting the future of our companies. So thank you.